Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. To get things started, please help me welcome to the stage the head of the drum program, Stuart Jean, and one of MI's most successful graduates, Ray Luzier.
Oh, Ray. All right, well, he's coming. How you guys doing? Everyone good? All right, room's a little bit full. We're getting there. He's talking to Billy Sheehan back there, so they're figuring out what songs are going to play. There he is. Woo! Have a seat, bud.
Here, man, I play rock music.
What?
What's up, everyone? Hey, look at this guy. Utah, what are you doing here? You live in Japan. What's up, everyone? You guys good? Crowd goes mild.
Yo, watch out.
Where's Doug at? Is he here? Look at this. What do you think?
No, thank you.
Represent my boy, Doug Nation, right here, everyone.
This is a record you guys made, right?
Well, this band is Doug's shirt, but yeah, I'm in a side band with Doug.
Okay.
From King's X. If you don't have those records, go buy them all today. Every single one of them.
Awesome.
It's good to be here, man.
Hey, glad to have you.
Yeah.
You're in town for
I'm in and out. I moved to Nashville. Now, so
yeah, I wanted to talk to you about it.
I lived here for 26 years. Went here when I was like 2 years ago in 88. 88, that's a long time ago. It was like, it came so far from, you know, where, when I was a student here. It was like 1 year crash course. How much can you possibly get in? Like jazz, Latin, funk, reggae, rock.
Oh, it's still like that.
Is it?
Oh, yeah, we cram it in, right? All right, yeah. Make these guys work hard,
yeah.
You know. So I wanted to talk to you about, you know, since you're here, you went through this program. The first thing I'd like to ask you is about, you know, there's a lot of students out here right now. You know, the day that they have orientation with me, that's when they're completely stoked and so excited to be here, and they're just ready to do this thing. And someone has asked them in their life, "You sure you want to do this? You know, you really, it's a giant commitment financially. Maybe physically moving across the country, finding a place to live. There's a big commitment here."
Sure.
And maybe a few weeks into it or a few months into it, you know, you're going to have some tough times. And I try to prepare them for that.
Yeah.
This is not an easy thing to do, you know, just learning this. And you're going to have some stumbling blocks and hit some walls.
More than that, yeah.
Yeah, you know, and I think the best advice you could give is, how do people get through that? Because I'm sure there's a lot of people in this room that could be one bad experience away from maybe leaving, you know, and giving up.
Man, you know how many times I called my mom crying? I can't take it anymore. I'm coming home. Like, yeah, because
I don't want to learn this Afro-Cuban
group. It's rough. It's let alone you're away from your home, most of us, right? Any LA locals?
Yeah.
A couple, right? But not most of you guys are from out of town, Japan and all over the place, so. Nice shirt, bonus points, man. But there's a lot that goes into it. I didn't realize, most of you guys are pretty young like I was. I was like 18 when I went here. And you don't realize how much is going on and how much information is coming in. And I kind of was a little bit, we're all naive at times, let's face it, you know. But I didn't realize how much that I should have absorbed quicker. You know, I was like pretty naive and I was like, I thought I was badass, like check this out, check this fill out, blah, blah, blah. And then like, you know, I had like, you know, Ralph Humphrey and all these people coming up to me going, dude, you need a metronome. I'm like, what, check this out, you know, just because I was off the farm, man. I was self-taught. I just played the records over and over and over again. So no one told me that I needed to get a metronome. You know, I was in marching band and concert, but I kind of just used that as an excuse to get out of school. I didn't realize how beneficial it was.
Mm-hmm.
So when my guitar player at the time talked me into coming here, you know, because Paul Gilbert was our neighbor in Pennsylvania. And he's like, dude, we got to go to L.A. I'm like, let's go to New York. He's like, no, we have to go to the school. You're like, MI's the place. Look at all these people coming out of there. And that's so he talked me into it. Lo and behold, I loved it. And he hated it and left after a year. And I stayed out. So, but it's hard to balance everything. You guys are going to get frustrated. You're going to get to a point where you're like, wow, you're going to be so overloaded. And then sometimes you'll lose focus of why you came here in the first place. You can never, ever lose that feeling you had the first time you picked up a pair of sticks, or the first time you plucked a guitar string, or the first time you picked up a vocal mic. You can never, ever lose that, because you can get caught up in the school like this and get bombarded with, like, overwhelming curriculum and overwhelming, and you're here and your lab mate shedding this, and you should be that level, and, you know, never, ever lose focus of what you're all about, and what you came here to do and your goals, because don't lose, I lost sight of that. I was just so overwhelmed. I was like, oh, and that's why I kind of pushed it aside. I was a student here pushing the curriculum aside, which was the biggest mistake. People thought because I was a teacher here that I aced all my tests. I barely passed. I got like 76s on everything because I just wanted to play. I was in all the LPWs. I was the drum slut of the school. I'd be in like seven bands, you know. It's like, am I allowed to say that?
Yes.
Slut?
Yes. Yeah, especially in that context, absolutely. Right, right, okay. And I always tell these guys, you should be in bands, man. You got to be in bands. So seven bands. See?
You have to be. I just wanted to play because I knew what I'd be doing the rest of my life, whether I was making a ton of money, whether I was – starving, whether this is just, I have to do it. There's no, what else am I going to do? You know?
Yeah.
I'm not that smart. I know I look intelligent, but it's like, you know, I knew that I'd be bashing my brains out for the rest of my life, whether it was teaching, playing disco, putting a wig on, you know, playing a stadium or playing a bar mitzvah, and I've done it all, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's like.
Yeah, that's the thing too, is from graduating from here, getting out of here, and then where you are now, there's a lot of time.
Yeah.
A lot of gigs. You did it all.
And right? I'm still learning, though. That's the thing. I'm 44. And I'm still, like, I have such a far way to go. And that's the beauty about what we do. We never, ever stop. And the thing is, with the great thing about MI, and at the time it was only a one-year program, I was opening those curriculum, like,
that's what was just
years happen. Later. Yes. Like, 3 years into it, I'm like, man, this one sticking thing's driving me nuts. What the heck? Oh, there was that one class, and I'd whip open my book. That's how valuable it is here. I mean, it's the gift that keeps on giving your entire life.
Yeah, you can get a 76 on a test, but you have that information your whole life.
Right.
Yeah.
That should be like my video reel. Like me in front of 80,000 people, and then like showing my test score. It really doesn't mean. I mean, I'm not trying to encourage you guys to get bad scores. I want you to, you know.
No, but that's the thing. Someone that gets a bad grade might feel like, oh, I'm not good enough for this, and I shouldn't do it, and that's discouraging. So they need to hear that it's okay. As long as you're working as hard as you can and taking it seriously, and absolutely.
Yeah. And ego and the ego attitude drug thing,
exactly.
Don't even fathom that. Like, if any of you guys are even contemplating that, especially you young kids out there, like, it's not worth it. I'm not trying to praise or push anything, but I've done my entire career with drug-free completely. So I'll take that applause.
Mm-hmm. That's not easy to do in that rock and roll world.
Don't get me wrong. I'm going to start heroin when I'm like 50, but no, I'm kidding. No, but like.
Antibiotics.
No, but it's true. Like all that stuff, I saw what it did. I hang out with a lot of rock stars. Trust me, that's how I make my living. People always say, like, what's it like to be a rock star? I'm like, I'm just a dude that hangs out with rock stars all the time, because it's always that, you know, I see the people in their mansions, and then I see people lose their mansions, their marriages, their career, their music, and I've seen it happen so many times. I'm like, why would you want to do that, you know? So stay focused is my point. Like, you know, there's so much to do musically. There's so much I need to do. You know, it's like every time I get on a kit, I'm like, I need to practice more. It's like, you know, and if you ever get to that point where you're like, oh, I'm good, I think I'll be good at this level, you should probably go to dentistry school or be a lawyer, because you're going to get bored real quick, you know what I mean? So that makes sense? Sorry, I had 103 fever like 2 days ago, so I'm I'm under the weather, above the weather, and in the storm. So if I'm like...
Well, we're happy you're here in whatever condition you're in. Yeah. So Nashville, you were in L.A., and what prompted the move?
Well, 26 years here, I'm still twitching from it, you see. I love L.A., I do. When you have munchkins, when you start having kids, and I started having kids at a very old age, I started at 40, which is crazy to some, but to me, I lived my whole life on the road, and I wanted to be fair to the kids. I didn't want to be like, a lot of bands will leave for 10 months a year, and they're like, you know, it's bad enough. My one son thinks that daddy lives out of a computer screen for Skype, you know? Mm-hmm. He's like, you know, that sucks. When he's like, daddy, you really exist? He's like, you know. So it's a lot different now, because my band all has a lot of kids. And we don't go crazy touring. With David Lee Roth, I would tour. Well, I would never see my apartment for 6 months.
Wow.
And I didn't care. Why would you want to go home when you're touring the world with David Lee Roth? Like, you know what I'm saying? So, mm-hmm. But when you have a family and you have, it changes everything. So, and some people have kids when they're 18. That's cool. Whatever. You work it out. But I chose to wait. So, mm-hmm. to answer your question, Nashville is a giant, giant music city. It's no joke. Like, it's nothing like L.A. It's a different kind of music thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's you go into an ice cream shop and some guy sounds like John Mayer pouring his heart out, and you're like, dude, you should be in a stadium. But that's the kind of, it's everywhere there, you know, different, you know.
Yeah, when you see all these big buildings, you know, that's all the music business.
Yeah.
That's all it is.
It's, and it's not country what people think. It's like, no. Dave Mustaine from Megadeth lives the next exit down from me. Mick Mars from Motley Crue lives the next exit up from me. Pete from Offspring, the drummer, lives right across the highway. I can almost see his house from mine. I mean, it's, there's a bunch of everything there, styles now. You
know, yeah,
so,
yeah.
So for me, raising a family, still being in a music town, you know, when you're in a big national band, you can pretty much live wherever you want.
Mm-hmm.
That's the cool thing about being in my situation. And Head, Brian Head Welsh, he lives in Nashville as well. So getting on an airplane to someone like me is like getting in your car, because we live on airplanes all the time. So a 4-hour flight to LA is really nothing.
How do you maintain staying in shape when you're on the road so much?
A lot of Ben and Jerry, Stuart.
Yeah.
My friend Ben, my friend Jerry. And
little Cherry Garcia.
No, people like Doug, you inspire me, because like this guy, he walks all the time, and he's a little bit older than me. And you have to stay in shape. Like right now, I'm really sick, and like it freaks me out, because if I was playing with Korn at a gig like this, the exertion it takes for 90 minutes, and if you've seen me play before, I don't really tap, so it takes a lot out of you. So you have to. I'm always the guy on the bus when all three buses are sick. I'm the guy that's well. I don't know what it is about my immune system, but you do build up. But let's face it, like someone like Korn, we go to South Africa 1 week, and then we're in Australia, and then we'll hit Germany, and then we'll come back to Texas. So it's, come on, you know, sometimes we don't sleep for days, you know. Yeah. Or we go to Japan, you know, and you're dealing with a 9-hour time change, 10-hour time change. Well, from Nashville, it's 7 for me now. So it's like, you know, that's hard as it is, you know, because your immune, yeah. You're going, wait, is this daylight? Is this, you're supposed to be sleeping?
Your sleep pattern gets messed
yeah.
up.
Yeah. So you just got to try to eat healthy as you can, you know,
mm-hmm.
and stay, you know, you wash your hands a lot because we're shaking hands. We do meet and greets constantly, you know. So, you know, I don't know what you have. I don't know what you have. I don't, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
It's like, I'd have the plague. I don't want that. So.
All right, so it's great you're in L.A. You live in Nashville. So what are you doing in town?
I'm just here hanging out, man.
Okay.
Twirling my sticks.
All right.
Yeah, we're writing a new record. Any Korn fans? Thanks, Mom and you. No. We're on the follow-up to The Paradigm Shift, which you all should have. You shouldn't have downloaded it illegally. You should have bought it.
Yeah.
Abel.
So what's the songwriting process? You're involved with the writing.
Yes, yeah. And that's a beautiful thing. I mean, I love – my band is so freaking cool. Like they – it's so hard to explain, because when you come around this environment all the time, you know, I enjoy teaching here a lot, because I'd come and watch – some jazz virtuoso, and I'd watch Weko and Vinny and all these people kill it on stage, and I'd go up and teach my double bass class or whatever, and then I'd come down and watch some, you know, reggae guy from Jamaica, and it's just, you know, it's a beautiful thing. My band's not exposed to that. You know, my band is five guys from Bakersfield that just put a band together, and they picked up an instrument and went, and the drummer picked up sticks and went, I guess I'm the drummer, and, you know, that's pretty much how they formed.
Wow.
And they made this just ruthless, dirty, nasty, in-your-face record that appealed to the masses, obviously, and it took off and it blew up. Funny story about that, I won't bore you guys, but with my first class here was a heavy metal live playing workshop, so I taught the LPW, and the first two songs we learned was Nirvana, Smells Like Teen Spirit, and Korn Blind.
Hmm.
And I remember hearing like the ride cymbal in the beginning of Blind, and it came in, and the tempo just went, and I was like, wait, we're teaching this to the kids? There's no, They think this guy thinks Time's the name of a magazine. Like, what? Like, so I just couldn't believe what I was hearing. But it was so ruthless and nasty, and just that I loved it. It, it had such a beauty about it. And obviously, 38 million records later, obviously they've. And yeah. This is, we're celebrating the 20th year anniversary right now, doing some shows, and I had no idea the fan base, and it's just. It's, so anyway, my point is writing with them, to be able to get in the studio and really see how they work, and they don't really go after, hey, hit the C major mixolydian D-Dorian 7-flat-5 scale. And we're gonna try, you know, there's none of that. I just made that up. You like it?
That's impressive. That was good. I like that. Yeah. Like you took harmony theory, I guess.
But there's none of that. There's no, hey, go to the B flat. Go. It's just they count frets, and it's this thing. And when it all comes together, it does this, and you're just like, whoa. And you see the chills on your arm, you're just like, you know, it made me play different because I'm on 77 plus records because I was a session guy for a very long time. Mm-hmm. But it makes you, like, wrap your head around stuff different because it just goes to show you don't have to have a piece of paper in front of you. It's there's many different avenues, you know.
Did you, yeah, first you joined the band, you had to learn all the existing material. Was there a transition to become really part of the team, or was that sort of immediate?
It took my, I was dry heaving the first week of Korn tour, like I, because we didn't rehearse at all. My band's like, ah, we've seen you play, you're good. And I'm like, no, wait, because Korn fans are ruthless, man. There's people with like five of the band members tattooed, all, you know, 12 album covers going down their legs. There's no joke. It's not like, oh, I kind of dig that Korn band. They're in it, you know. So they, I show up, they're like, who the hell, they don't care less who I am. It's like, I'm not the original guy. And I get it. I'm a fan, you know. Like, I hate seeing a new singer in Alice in Chains, but you know what? I love them still. I love that band, you know. So Neil Peart's not the original drummer in Rush. Isn't that crazy? 33 decades or whatever, and he's not the original. So it's like, my point is, you know, you have to grasp everything you, whatever's in front of you, and all. It took me a long time to get my head around it because their groove is so, so different. Mm-hmm. And that's my advice to you guys, too. When you guys try out for something, you audition for something, really try to get inside the music. Don't think you're going to dazzle them with your fancy fills and your licks, because I used to do that. Like, you know, I said, oh, I'm going to blow them all away with this, sextuplet, 30-second note thing. No, you just lost a gig. You know, I used to lose pop gigs left and right because I thought I was all badass playing this, you know, and they're like, cool, dude. We'll call you. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, really get inside. You guys get music to learn or something. Like, and some of you might saw my interviews, like where I say, you know, do your research. Like, Korn gave me 6 songs to learn. I learned 33.
Yeah.
Just because I wanted to be able to ready for anything. If they threw anything at me. Yep, sure. You know, I didn't want any doubts from them at all. So, that's a whole nother thing. You know, that's. I've been in so many cover bands and so many things that I have a vocabulary built up in my brain, vast amounts of music, you know. So start doing that, you guys that are younger and stuff. Like, build your vocabulary in your head because it does pay off when you're learning stuff, you know. And in a mega band like Korn, when you don't rehearse before you're playing in front of 30,000 people every night, you know.
Better be prepared.
Yeah, you got to be prepared, you know. And it was Terry Bozzio just played on the record we were promoting. So there's a lot of Bozzio parts, which I'm a huge fan of. So it was a lot of drumming, you know. Yeah. So, I was literally
wow.
backstage, you know. But once you get up there and you feel the power and you just, you know, you have to be confident, you know.
Absolutely, yeah.
Never let them see you sweat. Or if you are sweating, you better be confident behind that.
That's
sweat.
Right. Sweat with confidence.
Yes.
David Lee Roth, that was Zibbidi a big bop, that was a big geek for you. What's that?
Kidding. I had to like interrupt you because he—that's what he does. He just interrupts everything.
We just conjured up David Lee.
Yeah.
So was that an audition to get that gig?
That was we don't have enough time. If we had like 8 hours right now, I could really wow you guys with stories. Billy can agree. You know. Dave's an amazing, amazing, he's hands down one of the best frontmen of all time. No one can deny that. No one's ever done what he's done. No one's ever thought up with that crazy stuff that he does. He's quite the entertainer, you know. I always tell people, being in a band with David Lee Roth and having him as your roommate, two different things. Because on some of the lower budget tours when we had him as your roommate, you do not want to wake up with that guy. That's a.
You don't want to elaborate on that?
No. There's my mama taught me a lot of patience. Let me tell you something. You got like that's another thing about ego, attitude, all that stuff. When you deal with a mega rock star like David Lee Roth, there's so many different personalities and bipolarisms and eccentricities and all. There's so much stuff going on that. That's why people would drop like flies. I'd see the drum tech quit. I'd see the manager quit. There was one day I was at Dave's house. This was about 7 years into the gig. And I'm in his mansion in Pasadena. And he's leaning over the balcony without his shirt on, of course. He's showing me his abs. And he's all, hey, Luzier, you're the only one left. And I'm like, what are you talking about? He goes, think about it. The accountant, the drummer, the guitar player. And I'm like, yeah, what's wrong with me? Like, wow, like, what am I doing, you know? But
I'm out of here, dude.
The first day in the studio, I'm playing, and Dave's asking me all these questions, and I got hired to play on two songs. And that was kind of like a bucket list thing. Like, wow, if I get to play with David Lee Roth before I die, hallelujah, you know? Yeah. And I'm playing, and I saw him at the talk bag, and he hits the talk bag button, and he goes, someone take the bongo player to Starbucks. He's dragging. And I was like, wow. Like... So needless to say, I picked up the tempo, and he was asking me all these questions. He's like, what if I said swing this? What if I kick my leg? And I'm like, what is he asking me all these questions for? I'm like, I got hired to play two songs on David Lee Roth's new whatever. The manager, there's another piece of advice. You never know if you're auditioning or not. The manager calls me the next day and goes, all right, kid, you passed with flying colors. I'm like, passed what? He goes, you got the gig. I'm like, to what? It's like, Dave's put a new band together. You're the first member. I'm like, wow. Then I'm glad they didn't tell me because I'd have been way more nervous. I was blowing it off. I'm like, dude, you're a freak. You're asking me, like, crazy stuff, you know.
Nah.
Yeah. So you never know. Be on your game at all times. You walk into a situation, like even that day in the studio, I didn't know that I was shaking hands with all his personnel. I thought it was just studio workers. Mm. So you don't walk in and start barking orders at somebody just because you think they might be a studio guy or whatever. Be on your game at all times because you never know what's going to come back.
Wow.
You know?
Good advice. So, well, you guys want to hear Ray maybe play these drums up here?
Yeah. I like this talking thing.
Yeah, let's just keep talking.
Let's just keep talking.
We don't need to play.
Oh, I got to go. Sorry.
We just set this stuff up for pictures. Looks cool. You know, so.
Mr. Billy Sheen's here today, too. Billy? Yeah. Billy's such a... He's such a cool. I'm gonna play a track or two, and I'm gonna have Billy come up. He's such a cool guy. We're working on this bass and drum record. We have been for a couple of years now. It'll come out in 2026. Billy's awesome. I played on his last two solo records, Holy Cow and Cosmic Troubadour. And Billy's the kind of guy where like he's such a lifer, like myself. Like he'll just call me up, dude. Let's go play a cat club tonight, and we'll just jump in a car and go play some tunes. And that's I love that kind of no rock star ego bull crap.
Nah. Absolutely.
You guys want to hear some love ballads? Because I'm really sick. So if I can just play
Bossa Novas. Yeah.
Play some, yeah.
And you have a record out? You're going to have it available here?
Record, yeah, called KXM. Yeah. Okay. And Doug Pinnock from King's X is the singer and the vocalist. He's the meaning of soul, people. The soul that pours out of this guy. And I'm not just saying that because he's sitting here. Like, King's X has affected my life for many, many years. Super influential. People like myself, they have a cult following. I would fly to other states to go see King's X. That's how big. George Lynch is playing guitar. Legendary guy from Dokken and Lynch Mob and a million bands. And we're going to do some shows eventually, as soon as our schedules all get together. Korn keeps me really busy. Like, this has been the most off time I've had this year, which has been weird because I'm used to jumping on a plane every,
Right.
My first 4 months with Korn, we did 36 countries, not states, countries. So, yeah, I thought I had a brain tumor when I came back because I didn't know what today was. There is no Sundays, Wednesdays in that world, So, what do you guys want to hear? Slipknot. I'll play a Slipknot song. It'd be so funny. He's like, if you could just do that Joey thing, bro. There's like this Joey thing off Iowa. I'm just messing with it. What? Cannibal Corpse. Now we're digging. You're the only one who know that song. I'm just gonna mess around. I'll play a KX. Since you're here, Doug, in your honor, you're gonna be on tape today. But he'll come up like karaoke.
Thanks a lot, Bray.
Thank you. Damn it, Doug. Why you gotta write stuff like that? You sounded great. Doug didn't make any mistakes on that song. Me, on the other hand. So,
I call this clinic antibiotics. So, I just said this little groove. The cool thing about the KXM is we would just write the kind of rule, and me, Doug, made sure of that. It was like everybody had to write what was in the moment. Like, Doug's outside, puts jacket on. I started messing with this, I forget what the beat was, like a full beat at first. Something like that. Doug's like, what is that? I'm like, I don't know, I'm just checking my toms, you know. Takes his jacket off, picks his bass up, checks out, and then I turn it into a halftime thing. Just had this kind of like. Been done a million times, but not in a really of a rock sense, you know. Put it on the floor, tom, open the hi-hat, that. Right? Put a backbeat on the half, right? Make it groove, make everything groove. Come up with a pattern like that, make it feel good. If it doesn't feel good, change it so it does, or simplify it, right? And then, I've had that cymbal pattern for quite some time. Keep pulsing the quarters, and then just filling it in with the toms. A lot of beats, you know. Think, well, put a cymbal on the quarters of that, do the exact same beat, just fill it in around with the toms. So I'm going, of the cymbal almost sounds like someone else is doing it because you're doing this tribally kind of beat. So we wanted to be different on this record, you know, do some different stuff we never played before, some different grooves. There's a song called Faith is a Room where instead of just a steady beat, I made up a tom pattern that goes. Just a little different than a. Right? So that's one thing about this record. We didn't have any producers yelling at us saying, don't do that, don't do this. So, any questions on that? Hey? I can't see you guys out there. Hey? Anybody got questions? The crowd goes mild again. You're like, shut up and play something, Luzier. All right, I'll play something. You want to hear some Korns? You want to hear the Korns? I'm going to play the version with the C instead of not the K today. This is just a little medley thing of like stuff that we do live, and I'm not going to go too nuts with it because. Yes. We ripped that off of Slipknot. No. No, check this out. So this is just like a couple little songs in Z-flat for you. Tune down to Z-flat. Get ready for the iTunes back here. Here you go, brother. Yay. We'll be right back.
That last thing was a Bozio thing, can you tell? It's a drum clinic, so obviously I'm improvising, but. Any questions?
Yes. Technique for hitting. Great question. Here's the thing with, like what you just saw, that's about 60, I'd say maybe 70% of what I hit with Korn. Because, you know, no offense, but you guys aren't like 80,000 drunk people going, ah! So it's a totally different vibe, you know. So I hit very, very hard, but I'm holding my stick super loose. And Joe Picaro was my teacher when I went here, and I was gripping him like death grips, like, oh, I'm gonna kill everything. Watch out. See?
Yeah.
So, like, you know, he's like, he come up around me, Joe Poe, man. He's the coolest guy ever. Puts his arm around me, like, God bless you, kid. Look at you. You're so full of life. You gotta relax, man. You're gonna hurt something. And he was right, like, cause I was gripping these sticks and I was like, you know. And he's like, you can get loud volume, and you know, it looks. If you see me with Korn, you've seen me. It looks like I'm annihilating everything in sight. I'm so relaxed back there. I'm having a time of my life. The sticks are hitting my back. That's how hard I'm hitting. But I'm holding on. You'll see my hands. That sucker's like right there. You know, I don't choke up on the bat. My buddy Pete from Offspring, he holds them like way up here. I don't know how he does it, but he plays punk too, you know. I'm holding mine so loose back here. You get so much volume. Like, I don't even have to, listen to that, it's a gunshot. I'm not even picking my stick 8 inches. Freaking gunshot, right? I'm just whipping the whole molar thing. I don't know how far you guys are in the game, but the molar technique I swear by, the whipping thing, right? Never make your arms feel like they're doing something unnatural, because, you know, if it feels cramping, it's probably doing something wrong. So no matter what, you see me playing, like, all the stuff, but the heart's like, no, I'm even hitting rim shots on the tom sometimes. Gives it that volume, that big loud sound, you know. And I'm all about clarity. I'd rather, you're not gonna see me, I'm not, you know, a lot of dudes sit in their labs and they're practicing, they're like, I don't get that. Like, that's cool, it's fun, yeah, woo. Like, maybe your girlfriend's wild by it. I don't know. Like, I don't get it. Like, it's the stamina thing's cool. I'm not, drummer from DSI sitting right there. But I mean, it's cool. Like, I love the, but my point is, you're not gonna make, that kind of stuff doesn't make that much money, and I'm being honest. I travel the world a lot, and I see the bands playing that beat in clubs in front of 20 people, and they can't pay their phone bill. So if you get the Slipknot gig, different story. But my point is, like, get volume, get your, easy, calm down, dude. Calm down. But like, you know, you get the whole thing where get dialed in what you want to get dialed in. You know, I always joke around, I say the money-making beat, right, is that Phil Rudd, that's, you got to have the pocket. If you can do this for 5 minutes and not move. Do that for 5 minutes and not move, you're making a paycheck, I guarantee you, somewhere. Guarantee you, you know, playing all the fills and stuff, that's fine, that's, you know, but, you know, when you hit, going back to technique, you know, do, when you're laying into, even the faster stuff I do, I'm always about the clarity. I'd rather play something slow and pronounced than fast and sloppy. Nothing pisses me off more than when I watch drummers, like, play these hard grooves. What the heck was that? Stop that. I hate that. I want to go push you off your throne when I see you. If all of a sudden you're playing, you just feel that, that's me, because I came to watch you play. No. Like, play something convincing. If you're playing that beat, play something that, like, that makes me move, it fits the music, you know? And if you're going to play fast, let me hear the notes. I want to hear the clarity. I want to hear, we can all play sloppy, right? I'm good at it. We're all good at it. Playing clean is a whole other ball game. Pronunciation. Make sure you execute everything you do. All your ghost notes, it's up to us. We're given these tools. It's up to us. And our personalities will come through and shine through our playing. That's what's cool about us. That's why if we get every single guy in this room to come out and play the same exact beat, it's going to sound different, you know? And that's the beauty of it. We don't want to sound the same. We want to have our own characteristics. Careful on the cymbals. Like, I saw somebody play the other day. Not unless you're going to join the Ramones tomorrow or something. But, like, the punk thing, wow. The cymbals are just enhancements, you know? That a lot of drummers have that. They're making that face. Like, they're looking at the hi-hat. I can feel the hi-hat. I don't want to feel the hi-hat. Let me feel this, the groove. I want to feel the kick and the snare. This is just, you know, a great example of that is Jerry. The King's X drummer, all those cymbals, they're just spice. They're just salt and pepper. Like, he'll hit the groove and be like. And that hi-hat's just like, it's there if he wants it to be. He smashes it, but that's a great example. Like, be careful you don't focus too much on the cymbals. They're just enhancements that it beef up our groove and help us swing and move, you know. Another question. Huh? This is nothing, man. The Korn setup right now is like this. Don't ask me why. I don't know. It's like my ride is like this in Korn right now. It's the weirdest thing. I have no idea. Like it's heavy metal Buddy Rich. I have no idea. Because I sit too high. Yeah. Abel always knocks on me because I sit like, you know, on my Korn set, I go like this to sit down. I stand up and I go. It's pretty high, right?
My feet can't touch
it. He's shorter than me. He hates it because he's all, come on, man. But I like to be in control. When I sit high, I can't sit low, man. You want to bum me out of the gig? Have the drum throne break. Done. I get this whole thing going on. Damn it. I hate that. I have to be on top of stuff. And I think that's why the aggressiveness, even though where my cymbals are at, I hit cymbals completely wrong. Do not copy my cymbal technique. You can't hit a cymbal more wrong than me. I hit the shoulder of the stick on top of the pierce. I love to hear that. I love that. I don't do the whole, ooh, it's properly swished into the cymbal. That's not me, you know. But you see me, because I love the texture sound of that. Right? If you notice, these cymbals don't even move, which is a wrong thing to do. If my ride cymbal moves more than this, man, Catfish takes a beating. I hate that. I don't know what, there's certain things it's got to be. Like, I just, you know. These, my stacks are super tight. This is actually loose for how I have the stacks, you know. We play that song Narcissistic Cannibal. You know, if I'm playing. Depends on the groove. Depends on what you're playing, you know. So, it's up to you, you know. Use your time now at MI to adjust your throne. There's a billion things you could do. Just raising or lowering it an inch does, you know, crazy stuff. Billy, where you at? Billy, did he leave? I'm sorry. He got bored. Is it too much King's X talk? Any other questions? You guys know everything? Tell me, because, no, what? Hey. Billy Sheehan, everyone. Yeah. Now, be easy on him. He's only been playing about 3 weeks, so he's really timid, a little shy. I used to watch videotapes of this guy in Talus, and when I was in Pittsburgh, his first band. He's from Buffalo. I'm from Pittsburgh. Yeah.
From Buffalo. He's from Normal Parents.
Whoa, hey. Yeah. To answer your question very quickly, when when I, let me answer him real quick, and then I practice rudiment stuff. I don't go too nuts. Like lately, I've been working on my feet because my feet are sucking to me. I'm playing on this Australian metal record, and I don't. Man, one of the beats is like. For like 5 minutes. So I'm working on my feet right now because I don't really play like that anymore. Korn's very hard and heavy and not a lot of double bass. So I work on stuff that is coming up, or, you know, this band really wants me on their record. I'm going to give them my all, you know. So, but I work on a lot of rudiment stuff. I still do rudiments. You know, I'm still doing the accent exercises, triplets, 16th notes. I'm still doing the. Moving it around the kit, you know. Right? Putting something in between it. You know, have fun with it, move it around the kit. That's the kind of stuff I practice, you know. Bossa novas. I'm kidding, I don't practice too much of that. I work on my jazz. That was my jazz beat when I came there. Yeah. When I went to MI, they said, can you play swing? I'm like, yeah, I can play swing, whatever. Yeah, I almost got kicked out of the school onto the sidewalk. Yeah, I didn't know what touch was. I was like, yeah. You want to check out Billy's band, Niacin? I mean, he's in the Winery Dogs. They just finished up a new record. Richie Koch and Mike Portnoy. Woo! Gotta get that. But his side band, Niacin, with Dennis Chambers and
John Novo.
John Novo. Why do I always say Mike?
I don't know.
Mike Portnoy, everything. No. But check out Niacin. My God, the stuff they do on there. We're going to try a song off of the first record I did with Billy. It's called The Suspense is Killing Me. Right?
Good luck.
Let's try that. We haven't practiced this. I texted him yesterday. So he wouldn't come down. He's like, yeah.
Thank you.
we just wrote that just now. That was, wow, I remember that. Cosmic Troubadour, check out this record. It's really stuff like that. He's singing, playing guitar. It's great. The last one has Billy Gibbons, Paul Gilbert.
Yeah, Doug Pinnick came in.
Doug Pinnick, are you kidding? But me and Billy like to have fun doing stuff. He plays bass. Yeah, I can't even. I don't need to explain anything. Check out this next song. He can play the guitar parts and the bass parts. Come on, really?
We'll be right back.
Billy Sheehan, everybody. The one, the only. Nobody touches, nobody comes close to his cooking. He's a great cook, everyone. Seriously, it's an honor, I mean, he's changed the bass legacy forever. Everybody knows that. It's awesome to have him up. Stuart, where are we at? Sure. I got some CDs for sale, too, the KXM thing that I signed them, and if that nice gentleman over there, Doug Pinnick, would like to sign them, you can get double the two out of the three of us before you leave. Yeah, go ahead, man.
So what you think about when you buy your equipment?
When I what?
What do you think about when you buy your equipment?
Well,
Well, the equipment that you do buy.
When I, well, like we were talking about before, I'm fortunate enough right now to be endorsed, which is cool. When you play in a band that's very in demand and you have to have gear set all over the world, it's really important to get companies, you know. What I used to think about when I bought gear is we were talking about that car driving thing. Does it feel right driving your car? Of course you can drive anybody's, but you have to make it feel like your home. So that's what's great about GCs and Sam Ashes and all those places. You can go and sit and play on kits and see if it feels good to you, you know. Referrals, your favorite drummers, people you look up to, you know, that always attracted me when I was like, you know, it's just one of those, there's so many different elements in what we do that it's super important. But I'd say it's a combination of all that stuff. You know, people, you love that sound. Like if you love Bonham's sound, you might want to check out a Ludwig kit with big wide open 2002 Pisties, you know. That always did it for me, you know, and then I went from there. You know, it's a whole lot of stuff, though, man. A lot of, we have a lot of instruments. What's up, man?
You was next. Hi, how's it going? During the writing process, how does it go from between, like, electronic drums and all the weird shit that's going on now versus old Korn and, like, you, and what do you split up and how do you, like, incorporate that live?
You mean, like, the dubstep stuff?
Yeah.
You know what's cool about my band? And it's weird, like, AC/DC, Iron Maiden, the Stones, there's a lot of bands that they have this formula and they sound like that and you can pretty much predict what the next record's going to sound like, and that's okay because we all love it. I don't want to hear AC/DC play some dubstep record, you know, but I would hell, like whoa, 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 whoa. But like the cool thing about my band is we're very open to being experimental and I like that. You know, Jonathan come up to me and said, hey man, you know, because I thought I was sitting the year out. When I heard those, when Skrillex come in and started, we were programming the drums. My acoustic drums didn't hold a candle to those programmed drums. I was like, uh-oh, maybe Luzier is going to go golfing this year. But, you know, I love that. I love embracing that. And we did it. I had Pearl E-Pro kit, you know, and we had three Macs running behind me. And we played to a click track for the whole dubstep set. And I loved it, man, because it was challenging, playing that giant, like, every, it was just like, come on, through a PA in front of 30,000 people, that's power, man. So, but when I'd get to the old school stuff, and it was loose, and there was no click track, and the bend, I love that too. So, what was your question about it, sorry?
Just talking about it, just what it
was. Like, did you ask me something?
No, just talk about it. Just
yeah, yeah, it's very different, you know, and even Paradigm Shift, our last record, we wanted to make sure we sprinkled elements of that in there, you know, to make sure it wasn't just, especially because Head got back in the band, so four original and me now, you know. Mm-hmm. I've been in all pushing 9 years now, so it was really important to get that old school sound, but yet we want to be today. We don't want to be a nostalgic band that just keep pooping out the same records. You know, people do that, and it's, you know, well, cool thing about Korn, they have so many hits that we can always, you know what I mean, you're always going to piss someone off, and you're always going to, it's funny, because we did that dubstep record, all the old school fans were like, what?
Yeah.
And then, all of a sudden, we see like 18-year-olds with glow sticks going, oh my God, this is awesome, Jesus. It's like, what happened? I don't get it at all. And then all of a sudden, like, what's Freak on a Leash? I never heard that stupid song. Like, it was, because they only knew the dubstep
play
stuff.
Sabotage, and then they're like, what the fuck's that?
Yeah, dude, it was so bizarre. So, but hey, you know, it's that's part of life. And I hail Jonathan Davis for that, because he just loves going off the deep end. And I think that's what keeps us so alive, and we're so focused. And, man, thanks, awesome, man.
Thank you.
What's up, dude?
Hey, what's going on?
I know you.
How you doing?
Yeah. How you been?
I'm not too bad.
I've seen you in a long time.
Yeah, it's been a long time.
Don't ask me the meaning of life or anything.
That crazy weekend in Cabo, it was a good time.
Yeah? Was Sammy Hagar there?
I wanted to know, hitting as hard as you do night after night, besides, you know, not partying your ass off and eating right and all that, do you ever get any injuries from, like, muscular or
knock on bone? Everything, yeah. No. And I really owe it to the technique thing, man. You know, I think it's, I mean, come on, these are our tools. You know, I've been bashing my brains out since I was 6. And I'm like 27 now, so it's like, you know, 44. So, like, you know, that's a lot of abuse. I have construction workers that can't pick a pencil up because they're jackhammering every day, and it takes a toll on what we do, especially when you're playing something physical and like yourself. It's all about loose grip. I'm convinced, man. All my friends, I have a 26-year-old friend right now out on the road. He's calling me up with tears in his eyes. Like, what do I do? He's playing grooves, and the stick's just falling out of his hand, and his hand keeps moving, and the stick's gone. He's like, he didn't realize because he's going numb. Sometimes it's genetics. Sometimes it's our technique. I don't know what it is, but knock on everything, I'm pushing 45, and I've never had a problem, you know. One of these days, I'm going to have to slow down, and you're going to see me at the Holiday Inn going, hey, what's up, dude? hey, cool, man. Yeah. Yeah, remember that time I was talking about technique? F'd. You know, but I don't know. For now, but then I look at Tommy Aldridge. I did this drum festival, and freaking Tommy Aldridge, come on. He's 97, or I don't know how old he is now. He's like, and he's up there like, blah, 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 and he's hitting it with his hands. I'm like, stop it. Your bones are going to break. It's so inspirational, man. It's like, I'm convinced, man, it's technique, and I'm convinced it's something in our genetics. And every once in a while, when Korn's going strong, like last year, we killed ourselves. We did so many shows, and you get loopy after a while, and then you just get to the point where you're like, all right, here we go. And every night we say we're going to take it easy. We all do the same thing. All right, dude, let's just say there's only 10,000 tonight. Let's just take it easy. And we never do. If there's 200 people out there, we're going to give it our all. Because you'd be cheating the fans, you know. So I hate boring rock drummers. Let me go back to that real quick while we're talking about this. You know, I hate that whole waiting for the bus look. You know, David Lee Roth always told me, give the people a show. You know, people are always like, you know, I'm just playing what I feel. I'm not, like, playing the show. Have you seen me play Korn? I'm flipping my sticks. I'm not showing off. It's just that's what I'm feeling back there in my world, you know? And I hate that when I see this heavy band. And then you see the drummer going. I see it all the time. It drives me nuts, man. You're going to get pushed off your throne. You do that, and I see you. Gone. Just no. But give me a show. You know, David Lee Roth always taught me, you know, and that's one thing about, like, I always go back to the technique. He's like, people in the peanut heaven are paying money to give them a show. F you, Luzier. But it's true, like, you know, give them, these people are paying money. Just because we're in the back and we're the timekeepers doesn't mean we're not a part of the show, you know. So you don't have to be stupid and, you know, do that stuff, but you know. I thought that dumb. Yeah. Thanks, bro. Appreciate it. Hey, man, it's my pleasure to be here. To be back in this school after all these years, it's awesome, man. It's like, even walking through these halls, it gives me chills because, like, I remember, like, the whole having a test come up or having, you know, some smoking drummer that, you know, come walking down the hall. All that stuff comes flying back in a good way. You know?
I was wondering, when you're playing all those crazy drum parts, how much counting you do, and if you have any advice for counting?
I don't count now, but I did. I counted a lot. Like, I try to feel everything. You know, last thing you want to do is have someone watch your mouth, like counting to 5 or whatever. All the executions, it's all subdivisions, and it's all spacing and timing of execution in subdivisions. So if everything you play, that's why I always say, when you're in a metronome, people get too comfortable practicing in that 100, 120 zone. Get out of that zone. Go to 60. Go to 180. Go to back, you know what I mean? Get out of your zone in that. So everyone's so comfortable. So that's what I do. I start very slow, count stuff. Always do stuff slow. If you don't understand in your head, your band will never understand it. The audience will surely not understand it. You know what I'm saying? You got to be super confident every single time you play. I don't care if it's a, you know, bar mitzvah or stadium. You need to be confident.
So build that vocabulary in your head. Do you have a click track now, metronome? Mm-hmm. How much do you use it?
Pretty much every time I practice.
Don't use it every time you practice.
Okay.
You want to know why? First gig I did with David Lee Roth, I had an old R5 drum machine. He walks in, he goes, "What's this?" I'm like, "It's metronome." He goes, "Won't be needing that." He goes, "We play from the heart, brother. This is soul. We don't need that machine shit. Zibbity bop." And it was true. Like, I freaked out. That DLR band record I did, there's no click track on there. And I really was relying on that for my timekeeping. And he didn't want anything to do. It was me, John 5, just us playing the entire record together. And it was, we're looking at each other. He's like, "I think you're speeding up in that middle part." I'm like, I'm sure I'm speeding up in that middle part. I have no click track. Like, and I'm thinking about the parts. So that's my point. I say use your metronome 70, 75% of the time. Give yourself that 30 because you never know when someone's going to. Ross Robinson produced the Korn 3, Remember Who You Are record. No, his words exactly, "Don't insult me with your metronome." No joke. "Don't insult me with your click track." And I just went, "Oh, yeah." He goes, "I won't let you ruin this record with a click track." So we went to 2-inch tape and no click track. So think about it. If I was relying on this in the back of my head all the time, I would, you know. So that's why I say all you guys, bass players, guitar players, whoever, don't use it every time, you know. I mean, granted, a lot of today's bands are all on tracks. A lot of people, the whole band run click tracks. It's crazy. We toured with that band Flyleaf. They all run click tracks. The singer, boop, 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 boop. She's singing with this annoying click. I couldn't believe it. But they're on point every night. It's their freaking machine, you know. So, thanks,
Thank
man.
You. Hi, Ray.
Hey, oh, look at you. Oh, no photographer question. Sorry.
No, this is from the interview we did a few years ago. You told me the story about Dave being used to the Pisces sounds and then Zildjian and then your cymbals. And you said how he hated your cymbals at first because it was Sapien. Just about adapting, you know, to the artists with your companies.
It's true. When you have rock stars as eccentric as David Lee Roth and they know what they hear, a lot of times they can't put their finger on it, but they're like, "There's something different about it." I had all Sapiens and Sapien gave me my first shot. They believed in me as a drummer. I didn't have to sell a million records. I didn't have to play an arena. They said, "Hey, we like your talent. We think you're going places," which was very cool because not many companies will do that when I was playing clubs in L.A. So, not many Sapiens don't sound anything like a Paiste 2002 or, you know, we all know that. And Dave had that look in his eye like, "Something's weird on your kit. I don't know what it is, but fix it." You know, and I'm like, you get that. And so I'm like, and I listen back to the track, and I was using these rock crashes, and I'm like, "Oh my God, they sound nothing like Alex Van Halen." And he's used to hearing that shimmer of a 2012. Chad Smith just came out with a signature series. It was 18 and a half and 20 and a half cymbals. They were weird, but they sounded just like a Paiste. So I called Sabian. I'm like, "Give me 7 of those right now." And that's what a lot of that's on the DLR band record, the stuff I'm, you know. So I hit that crash, and Dave's like, "Sounds great. I don't know what you did, but it sounds great. Keep it up." So I kept my gig, but yeah. Oh, thanks.
The other thing we talked about was when you'd first joined Korn, you know, coming into a band that had been together, all original members, and then, you know, taking a place, what that's like, you know, fitting in with them in the beginning.
There's no band like Korn on the planet. If you'd have told me 15 years ago I'd have been a member of Korn, I would have laughed in your face, you know, because I have no sleeve tattoos. I got no. The original drummer didn't have that. You know, he had a short hair thing. But it's a whole attitude. It's a being. It's a sense. It's not. It has nothing to do with your technique and how virtuoso you are and how many hours you practice. It's a lifestyle. Korn is this. It's its own monster, and it changed the lives and impacted so many people. You see people in South Africa, in Cape Town, crying, you know, because they had some abuse or something in their lives, and they're like, "Korn saved my life. I was going to kill myself." And you're just like, that's heavy, man. That's how powerful music is. So you never underestimate what we can do with our instruments and the feeling we give people. And it does save, you know. So joining that band, it took a lot to wrap my head around. I mean, for weeks and weeks, my previous band, Army of Anyone, had Robert and Dean DeLeo from Stone Temple Pilots and Richard Patrick from Filter. And we were on the same management. And Korn was going through a lot of drummers. They had Joey from Slipknot filling in. They had Bozio. They had Mike Borden. They had Brooks Wackerman.
you know, all these different people, and I'm like, what's going on with Korn, man? That's weird. Why didn't they find a drummer? At this time, my band was disbanding, unfortunately, and the rest is history. I learned those 33 songs, and I played 6 songs at soundcheck in an empty arena. Joey Jordison's drum set was behind me on this enormous riser, and they rented me this really, really bad 5-piece kit to play, and it sounded like poop. And I just gave them my all, and they shook my hand and said, we'll see you in Dublin. You got the gig. And I went, cool. What? You know, I had no idea what they did. It didn't even hit me. You can watch it on YouTube. My audition's on there. You can see my face. I'm like, oh, that, wow, thanks, man, cool. Because that's really, you're in Korn, right? Because that's, wow. So you want me to, that's all right. You could see my nervousness because I had no idea. Like, it didn't hit me for, like, I kept calling my manager going, so I'm in the band? He's like, well, you're going to do the tour. You're not in the band, but they really like your playing. And so then 2 years go by, and they go, hey, man, we don't want you going anywhere. And I'm like, I don't want to go anywhere. They're like, well, let's make you a member. Let's figure this out. And I'm like, wow. So you went from a hired gun now to a full member, which writing and everything's involved. It's a whole other level, especially in a band like this. My work got a lot more. I used to just go to soundcheck. None of those guys would show up. It'd be me and the back keyboard player playing through tracks and then doing the show. And I'd be like, all right, now what for 22 hours? You know, now it's like, all right, Luzier, here's your press schedule. And here's your signings. And here's your, it's just like my work never stops all day. But I love it. I mean, I start at 1 or 2 in the afternoon. I start doing all my press. Sometimes it's me and Monkey, me and John, me and Head, whatever. And then my band's such freaks that we write all the time that, like, even after the show, John's all pumped up and jazzed from the show that he's like, man, I wrote this song, check this out. And he's just, it's crazy. Like, the music that they just keep writing and writing, it's such an awesome thing. A lot of bands, when you get in your 40s, like, you get kind of over it, you know, especially bands that have been around and have had such huge success. You get to that point where you're like, yeah, let's get this crap over with and get the paycheck and go home. I've been in bands like that, and it sucks. You know, these guys are like, they're on fire, and it's awesome. What, you cutting me?
You want to do one more song and call it?
I got 37 songs. This was like a week-long thing.
Well, we'll do one now, and then we'll move you upstairs, and we'll do 36 more.
Sure. How much? What time is it?
It's like 9:45.
Wow. Time flies when you're having fun at MI.
Well, first off, let me thank Rick. Thank you for being here.
Oh, of course.
Everyone, man. Please.
Thank you. My extreme pleasure. It's really cool to, like, you know, just to be back here in these walls and feel all the energy and see how far the school has come. Stuart was going through with me, like, the curriculum and how you guys do it now. It's freaking amazing, man. It was not that organized when I went here. So.
Well, thanks for sharing all that insight.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Of course. And again, like, I'll be hanging out for a little bit afterwards. If you guys have a KXM CD, I signed it. Doug will sign it. Are you taking off soon or no? You can be here. Dude, you got 2/3 of KXM signing it. That's like, it's worth at least $1.50 on eBay. Right? What do you want to hear? I got like millions of songs. Freak on a Leash. I don't have that individual. The only Korn stuff I have is the medley stuff. I have the new Korn.
Get out.
Are you serious? Yeah. Are you serious? I don't know why I'm talking like that. Right now. Wow. Narcissistic Cannibal. Wow. That was good. You can't speak English, but you can say Narcissistic Cannibal just fine. That was awesome. He's like, Narcissistic Cannibal, Ray. No. I don't have that much time. I'll tell you what, I'll play a little bit of Narcissistic, and I'll play, how about Love and Meth? Nice.
Yeah.
See? All right, I'm gonna stop Narcissistic just because I'll show you the dubstep. So this is going from extreme dubstep Korn to Paradigm Shift, when Head got back in the band and we wrote fresh and we started this whole new thing. So, but check out the stiff approach, even on acoustic drums. And the way I play this trash cymbal, I'm not accenting, I'm not doing the whole, I'm not doing all that. It's all about robotics and dubstep. So I'm like, I'm hitting every single note with the shoulder of the stick on this trash cymbal, which makes a very, very cutting sound, right?
scared about the hell you put me through. I just need to look around.
Thank you. So you see, there's like a different kind of power to those. There's a little bit more, you know, funkier. Everything's got to be kind of funky in Korn. It's not just metal. It's not extreme, you know. So that was a big thing for me to get used to for a while, is don't play just straight rock, you know. Make it move. Make the soul, you know. It's important with whatever band you get into or whatever band you're writing with, make sure that you're doing that. You're feeling what's going on in music. I don't think drums ever. You know, I think parts. To work them out, but once I'm on stage, there's no way I'm sitting back there thinking about drums. I'm humming the songs, I'm singing along with the words. You know, play as musically as you can, because that's gonna make the band feel that much better when you play musically. You know, when you're thinking drums, it'll come out stiff and stale, and it's okay to think at first to get your parts down, but it's all about the music, you know, at the end of the day. And if you're thinking that and you're feeling it inside, the audience is definitely gonna get off on that, you know. So, thanks a million for having me. I'm gonna hang out somewhere, maybe over here. Thanks again, guys.